I'm Eric Atkinson from Kansas State University. It's our pleasure now to visit with the individual who's just been named the Alumni Fellow for the College of Veterinary Medicine at Kansas State University. And he is a graduate of K-State multiple times, as a matter of fact, and a native of Kansas who has forged a very successful career in bovine medicine. Joining us now, Dr. Bob Smith. Bob, congratulations on this recognition, first of all.
Thank you very much.
Let's go back over where you started and clear back to where you grew up in Southeast Kansas, correct?
I'm a native of Southeast Kansas, and I went to school in the Frontenac, Pittsburgh area, and that's pretty close to as far southeast as you can get in Kansas, 5 miles from Missouri and 20 miles from Oklahoma. So we had a small farm outside of Pittsburgh or near Frontenac also, and I guess that's where my interest in veterinary medicine began, because we had a few cows that we milked, a few beef cows, and a few horses, and we farmed a little bit. My dad also worked off the farm, and so I was the one that really enjoyed the agricultural part, and it seemed like veterinary medicine would be a rewarding career, and that's where the interest was spawned.
So you began that pursuit with an animal science degree at Kansas State University?
I did. I received my animal science degree here, and was also in Army ROTC. And I was commissioned as a second lieutenant in the Army Air Defense Artillery, and did 2 years of active duty, and trying to decide, do I need to do a PhD in ruminant nutrition, or should I go to veterinary school? So after a lot of thought, and I decided I was going to try veterinary school, and I haven't regretted it a bit.
And what swung you in the direction of vet school?
You know, actually, as I think about my colleagues on the animal science side who are doing feedlot consulting as nutritionists, we do a lot of the same things. So it's just a matter of, do I move a little bit farther toward medicine or a little bit farther toward, you know, just the metabolic issues and the dietary issues? And it was a, you know, again, not a big difference between the two, but I decided I'd go on the veterinary side and made that choice, and it's been very good. It's been very rewarding.
So you earned your Doctor of Veterinary Medicine at Kansas State in 1976, and where did your career begin from that point?
You know, as I approached graduation, I thought, you know, what do I want to do? Do I want to do small animal or do I want to do large animal? And I actually enjoyed them both a lot and enjoyed equine. So the decision became pretty tough, but I decided I wanted to concentrate on a more narrow area. I have the greatest respect for mixed animal practitioners because they cover so many species and they do it well. I wasn't sure that would be what I wanted to do, and maybe I wasn't as smart as some of the mixed animal practitioners. And so I applied for an internship at a couple of universities and was accepted at both. And went ahead and went to Oklahoma State University and did an internship in large animal medicine and surgery. And it was a rotating internship where we were equine and all the farm animal species. And then I stayed on for their version of a residency. And then they decided they wanted me on faculty for a while.
And so you joined the faculty at Oklahoma State University and spent a quarter of a century there, is that correct?
I did. There was a little break in the middle, but I had a really, really good job while I was there. I was charged with the field services section, and we were busy. We had two trucks out on the road every day with two students each, and we had a thorough truck, a reproduction truck, that was out for half a day. We were able to develop that practice so that we had about 15 dairies on a regular herd health program. We had beef operations, and I also did a lot of equine work during those early days, probably saw as many horses each year as most of the equine clinicians did. So, and then we, of course, taught a lot of classes along the way. And during that quarter of a century, I decided to go out into practice. And I was with Paladuro Veterinary Services in Canyon, Texas, with Dr. David Bechtel, who was one of the premier feedlot veterinarians, and spent a couple of years with him. And then Oklahoma State calls, and they said, would you be interested in an endowed chair? Well, I think that sounds pretty interesting. And so my last 8 or 9 years there was a little bit different. I did more industry service, extension, and had a small research appointment, but also had the opportunity to interact a lot with livestock organizations, such as chairing the Cattle Health and Wellbeing Committee at National Cattlemen's Beef Association and working with beef quality assurance programs and things like that.
So you had the best of both worlds academically and very much applied throughout your career, it sounds.
It was very great. It was just outstanding. The people that we got to work with, the students and fellow faculty and the clients, were great. Plus, that route got me involved in a lot of other things in organized veterinary medicine, as well as with the NCBA and the State Livestock Association. And it was just a very, very rewarding time that we had there.
A generic question here. What has changed most dramatically about bovine health management over that time, your tenure at Oklahoma State and the ventures on the side, so to put it?
I thought about that a lot. You know, in my seminar today, I talked a little about James Herriot, who wrote those wonderful books back in the 70s and 80s, and described his practice activities for several years there in Yorkshire. And many of the calls that I made even 40 years ago when I graduated were much like his. There were small farms and the producers were extremely dependent upon the veterinarian. We did things that they do themselves now. So as the next generation came along, we see them doing the simple things themselves. And so we're doing more of the things that we've been trained to do. And obviously we're trained to do the simple things, but now we're used more for developing preventive medicine protocols, therapeutic protocols, monitoring disease trends and diagnoses and things like that. So we still get dirty. We still palpate some heifers, and we do necropsies, and we do some minor surgeries and so forth. But a lot of our time is spent training people on these larger operations. And in addition, we do a lot of time analyzing records to see where we've been, where we are today, and where we need to go, and providing advice along that line.
It's interesting you say that, given a contemporary issue with the veterinary feed directive, where it's sort of going the other way now. Veterinarians being brought back in to, in this case, prescribe antibiotic use to cattle producers, other livestock producers. That may be a one-time thing, perhaps, as opposed to a total shift of the trend, you would think.
That's true. Yeah, that veterinary feed directive will be interesting. And you know, the underlying reason for that, and I think it's important that everyone understand that it's not an attempt by the industry, the profession, or the government just to take away all the tools. But we're facing some issues now that we've not faced before, and that's being antimicrobial resistance. And so in order to preserve the usefulness of the antibiotics that we have, it made sense to use those for control, prevention, and treatment of disease, and not just for growth promotion. And I think also society will view us more favorably now that we've taken that out of the mix.
Of course, Bob, you're still very active in the field.
Yes.
What do you consider the grandest challenge before the industry, that is, cattle health management at this moment?
There's several out there. You know, number one, we still face losses that I don't think that we should face, death loss we're talking about. And as you analyze that, everything has to be well managed from conception all the way through the chain. So I think there's an opportunity for us to capture some of these losses and turn those into opportunities by continuing to work diligently to educate the producers and educate veterinarians too about the importance of stress management, for example. If we would eliminate the need to castrate these calves when they arrive at a backgrounding operation or feed yard. By doing that when they're baby calves, we do it when it's less stressful. We do the surgery and the calf runs back to its mama and it's pretty happy again. But if these calves arrive at a stocker operation in Kansas or a backgrounding operation as bulls, they're three times more likely to become sick and 2.7 times more likely to require retreatment if they do become sick. So that takes us right back to the use of antimicrobials. So there's more antimicrobial usage, there's more exposure of that drug to those pathogens, and so they're going to develop resistance. And in addition, when we have a sick animal, it has a greater chance of dying. Very simple logic right there, especially if it's a retreat. And such things as nutrition of the cow and the heifer while she's pregnant can impact the health and productivity of the calf its entire life. So I think the first thing that we do is we continue to address basic animal husbandry. And when we do that, we're going to have better health and productivity outcomes. And these products that we use today, such as antibiotics, will last much, much longer. In addition, there's a lot of economic pressure on our clients. You know, in the old days, they could own a quarter section and have a little corn, a few beans, and have a few cows and put a kid through college. You can't do that anymore. The margins are low. And so as a result, they have to have more animals in order to generate enough income to maintain a decent lifestyle. So the risk is greater when that happens. So we have to work with these clients, preparing ourselves to give the right information, working with these clients so that we can give the advice so that they can make a living with the livestock that they have. Because again, margins are low, so there's not much room for error there. So the economic pressures are great. In addition, we're facing more and more pressure from the environmental side. And there's this word sustainability that we're throwing around now, and I'm not sure we completely know what that means yet, but to me, it means preserving the resources that we have, in particular natural resources. So that encompasses everything from range management to water quality, water quantity, and how we manage things like that, and efficient productivity of the animals that we have on our farms and ranches and feedlots. So to be sustainable, we have to pay attention to the environment, we have to pay attention to animal welfare, we have to pay attention to food safety, and also we're going to have to do a better job of convincing the public as to why we use various technologies that we use today.
On that latter count, is headway being made in informing and educating the public on why we do what we do in maintaining cattle health?
I don't think we're there yet. You know, social media is an extremely powerful tool. You know, my age, I never dreamed that social media would have the impact on what we do as much as it does, but in fact, it's an extremely powerful tool. And we have to develop a good science-based response to people that have concerns so that they understand that we have less land mass every year. And from 2008 to 2015, we lost almost 1 million acres a year of farmland and pasture land, expanding communities, you know, housing additions and airports and highways and so forth. And we can't replace that. When it's gone, it's pretty well gone. In addition to that, we have a growing population. And the only way to increase our productivity, whether it's crops or whether it's livestock, is that we become more efficient. And a lot of that comes through technologies, and people are questioning that. And it's good that our government requires us to prove that these things are, in fact, safe for the animals and safe for the people. We've got to get that message out. And we're a long ways from convincing the public that we're doing the right thing. It may not be the majority of people that's concerned about this, but those that are very vocal, and we need to respond to those people in a professional way so that we can continue to move toward feeding this expanding population.
And it's not an easy task.
It's not an easy task at all.
Diligence.
A lot of diligence.
As far as the future of the practitioner profession, if you will, serving the cattle industry, and again, there have been challenges for young people getting into this field, and economic and otherwise. How do you perceive that future? And if we can have adequate volume of practitioners out there for the cattle sector?
There's a lot of people that think that the future is bleak or dim for that part of veterinary medicine. I don't agree with that, not at all. You'll see young veterinarians who will go out into a community that have good communication skills, they have good medicine skills and some business skills, and they can grow a practice because they're providing service that's needed. And what I foresee in the future is that we won't see as many young people going out into rural America to a small town and being solo practitioners. If they want to, that's fine. But as I look back and think about the people that preceded me, a lot of these veterinarians got out of World War II. They went to veterinary school and they set up a practice in a small town. And then that practice was purchased by veterinarians that would have served my parents. And they lived their whole life there. And now that they shut those down because nobody wants to buy them. What I think the future is for rural practice, so this also includes bovine medicine, would be the regional practice that's a group of people where one may be especially gifted in the care of the horses. Someone is more interested in cattle, and maybe one's interested in cow-calf, another in a stock or in feedlot, I don't know. That'll vary from practice to practice. And you'll have those in the clinic that'll be small animal people with interest in internal medicine and surgery. And so when somebody needs to be gone, somebody else is there to fill in. And at the same time, when they're there, they've got somebody to communicate with. The millennials, and obviously I'm not a millennial, they like to interact with people a lot more than the older generation did. They want that professional support. So I think that people with those skills that we discussed, business, communication, medical skills, I think they can put together practices which will provide them a very comfortable lifestyle, and at the same time provide a real service for these small communities. And there are needs out there, whether they're small farmers or large farmers, there are needs for good professional service from veterinarians. And the training they would get at institutions such as Kansas State prepare them to do that.
Last thing here, what this recognition as the Alumni Fellow for your alma mater, the College of Veterinary Medicine, means to you?
This was a very big surprise. I mentioned to my wife when we were flying into France to represent the U.S. beef industry at the World Health Organization's Animal Welfare Conference, that as we're descending in toward the Paris airport, there's a thick layer of clouds there and the Eiffel Tower sticking through, and I turned to her, and we didn't go to high school together, but I asked her, I said, did you ever in your wildest dreams ever think we'd have the opportunity to do something like this? And she goes, no. Driving up here yesterday, I looked to her and I said, do you think in your wildest dreams as a teenager, you think we'd ever be participating in a ceremony like this? She goes, no, I didn't think so. So it's the faculty, it's the administrators, it's the taxpayers of Kansas that provide the opportunity for us to learn here, and it opens up doors. And I've had a lot of doors open for me, and I'm extremely grateful. I've been wonderfully blessed to have many, many opportunities to serve the profession and to serve the cattle industry. And to receive this award, though, when I think about so many deserving people, is a very humbling experience at the same time. And but I'm truly honored. It's really a big deal.
It certainly is well deserved, Bob, and congratulations. Thanks for the comments right here, likewise.
Thank you.
He is a 1976 graduate of the College of Veterinary Medicine at Kansas State University, longtime faculty member at the Vet Med School at Oklahoma State University, and currently a veterinarian with Veterinary Research and Consulting Services, LLC, out of Stillwater, Oklahoma. His name is Bob Smith. And Bob has been named the Alumni Fellow for the College of Veterinary Medicine at Kansas State University for 2016.